This week's episode of Talking Simpsons is brought to you by you. That's right, we're on Patreon now, so head on over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. For as little as $5 a month, you can help our show and get all kinds of great extra content on top of that. We've got a ton of great bonus content waiting for you right now, so head on over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons today.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where the children are always wrong. I am your host, Bob Mackey, some sort of non-giving-up podcast guy, and this is the Laser Time Podcast Network's chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me today?
Happily mortgaging his future, Henry Gilbert.
And who else?
Chris Antista does it 9 months a year. Huh.
And today's episode is The Boy Who Knew Too Much.
The joys of mortgaging your future.
And that episode aired on May 5th, 1994, and as always, Chris will tell us what happened on this day in history.
The Three Ninjas kick back in their very first sequel. John Wayne Gacy has been executed, and Ever the Simpsons Companion, Rock, starring Charles S. Dutton, takes a bow after four seasons.
Oh, wow.
I thought that was incredibly important to mention. I know we've made asides to that, but when The Simpsons moved to Thursday, it was always before Rock. Show I never loved, but watched a lot of because
of
The Simpsons.
And they eventually made it a live show.
They did,
to
save themselves.
Sweeten the pot.
Mm. He would hold, like a hostage, he would hold up a newspaper of today's headlines and like, yeah, it's going to be a live show. But
it didn't save Undateable either, though, going live. But,
on an all-new Rock. It is synonymous with me with the first couple years of The Simpsons. And odds are, if you lived in America, same for you.
It's so interesting, too, that The Simpsons on those nights got paired with not one, but two shows with an African-American lead, like Martin and Rock.
Living Color.
In Living Color.
Because Rock was the single guy in the middle of its Friends and Seinfeld sandwich.
Yes, yeah. But this would be the end of this. We're getting close to the end of the Thursday of Simpsons. They'll be on Sunday
back
soon.
On Sunday.
But it wouldn't be the last preachy black sitcom.
No. My favorite...
Talking about Tyler Perry's House of Pain.
All 800 episodes of it. One of my favorite new shows is Carmichael, which is kind of... when you said Rock, it made me think of the Carmichael show, because they both are like very traditional styled old sitcoms that like basically never leave the living room of a big house.
But have giant long conversations. Mm-hmm. And with the difference there is that David Alan Greer gets to play the Archie Bunker character, and that makes it awesome. The Carmichael show will give you faith in the sitcom.
Cool.
Oh, Dag is awesome. You should Dag is awesome on it. Mm-hmm. In the first season, if I were to direct you to watch a couple Carmichaels, the one about Black Lives Matter was really good, as was the one about guns and is it okay to own a gun or not?
I heard about both of these episodes. Mm-hmm. I forgot about the show, but talking about...
I saw it in getting my sandwich, and that's what made me fall in love with it. Oh. Like they ring the doorbell, and David Alan Greer answers like, "Where's Mom? She's in the goddamn kitchen where she belongs." I'm just kidding. She's in the kitchen, but on her own volition.
And Simpsons Connection, Mike Scully does work on that show.
So. Oh, he does. Okay. Yep, yeah, we mentioned the Three Ninjas, and that was sort of the like post-Home Alone kids beating up adults genre. And all I remember the first movie, that's the only one I saw, is they defeated one of the villains, or maybe all of them, by giving them diarrhea.
Yep. Yeah, it was
they mixed a potion that gave one of them diarrhea.
They marketed it as in like, Home Alone is for queers. We really prank these burglars.
We got fucking nunchucks. We're gonna break them.
I think they had to get at least silly with diarrhea, because otherwise it's like these kids are punching adults and that feels weird. But then I remember, I think my mom said it when we saw the first one, of like, that kid's six. No matter how good a kid is at karate, he punches me in the face, I'm not going down.
It's a kickback. Or Three Ninjas, sorry. Yeah, I was just thinking of Home Alone, which the latter half is just a Warner Brothers cartoon.
Oh, no. I love it. Their heads would have been caved in three times in the
that
first
is like
Home Alone.
8 minutes of a two-hour movie, just that scene. It's much shorter than you remember. But yeah, today's episode is all about Bart witnessing something and then having to hold the secret deep within his heart.
Yes. Yeah. A 12 Angry Men-ish?
Sort of.
A little bit. Hitchcock title?
Yeah, the Hitchcock stuff does not figure into this at all.
It is what's a great John Swartzwelder episode in that it is just a mess of things, but everything's great and crazy and wacky.
And lots of making fun of Democrats.
Yeah.
Specifically the Kennedys.
After the previous episode, which was Bart befriends Skinner, 1 week later you were seeing an episode where Skinner tries to kill Bart.
They should have been in reverse order.
Yeah, it's a bit of a flip for Skinner, who just forgot about how he connected with Bart. But
I'll maintain that sweet Seymour Skinner's Badass song should have been the season finale to dig into a character that hard.
I think that's why they ended up with two Skinners together, is that they rearranged that one. They chose that one to be the 100th one, for that to be the event one, because they wanted a Bart-focused episode. So they just moved it to a different time, and maybe they should have shuffled a little bit more And if they'd had Lady Bouvier here instead of this one, it would have at least been like a swap. Yeah.
I believe the intended season finale was supposed to be Bart of Darkness.
Yes, the summer episode.
But there was an earthquake, and we'll get to that soon.
Yeah, give us 4 or 5 weeks, folks.
Yes, but yeah, today's episode is all about how school is a prison, and there's even a prison bus to pick you up.
Prison bus, Otto?
The regular school bus broke down, so take a seat before I blow your heads off.
Otto!
Sorry. This bus and I have sort of a shining thing going on.
That's the most Otto's had to do with a joke of, like, that joke has more to do than just Otto likes rock music or Otto is a stoner. It's that Otto is being driven crazy by this bus.
Yeah, there's nothing really Otto-ish about that joke. No. He's just the bus driver.
Well, and his voice kind of becomes Jasper at the end there, too.
A little bit.
Fine line between Jasper and Otto for Harry Shearer. But
is Jasper Otto's dad? Quick, write a bad article about this.
I can, if we were really out to get rich, that would be all we'd be doing. We wouldn't be doing this show. We'd be just doing videos with a picture of, like, Otto is Jasper's Otto's dad.
Here's a visual example of a forum thread I read.
But the this is so Merkin-y too, of, like, school is a prison and horror, and it's torture to children for no good reason.
I haven't had a chance to mention it in a while, but that is exactly how I felt at Bart's age.
Same here. It's why I love this show. It's like, oh my god, they're speaking directly to me. They're not saying school is so wonderful and fulfilling. They're like, no, it hurts and it's painful and you just want to be outside and free.
And I think there were still worry warts and watchdogs, like, slandering the Simpsons. It was like 4 or 5 down on the notches that, like, they make school look like a prison.
They're attacking American institutions on that program.
And the Shining reference is kind of a tell of that. In, like, about 6 episodes, though, 6 months, they're going to do the greatest Shining parody ever done.
But Otto didn't say shinning because he wasn't afraid of being sued.
Yeah, it's true.
So one of the tortures Bart has to endure are these new posture chairs.
Yes, yeah. Well, Bart's imagination of Huck Finn.
Oh, right.
At first it was like, well, Bart would never have read this book, even if they forced him to. But then
he'd learn a lot of awful words.
That would show him... I guess his ignorance is shown because Lincoln is there, which he even misspells. Did you catch that? He says L-I-N-C-O-N.
He doesn't. He leaves out the silent L. Lincoln.
But yeah, things don't get any better once he gets to school.
Our new ultra-hard posturific chairs have arrived. They've been designed by eminent posturologists to eliminate slouching by the year 3000.
Wow. Mrs. Krabappel, I'm having back spasms.
I know, they seem a little uncomfortable right now, but eventually your bones will change shape.
I lost all feeling in the left side of my body.
Yeah.
Okay. So one, they hadn't invented the term ergonomics yet.
Right, I guess not.
It's posturology.
Posturologists.
And this is a dumb story, but it did happen in my school, and that always made me understand the Milhouse joke a little better. This girl came into class, sat down, and then bell rang, and she couldn't stand, and the hospital had to come get her. Oh. And they're like, what? She's fine. She comes back to class the next day, and the exact same thing happens. So, like, something in the chair would, like, Vulcan nerve pinch her into where she could not use her legs. That happened in my high school.
I think we've learned, or maybe they knew even then, that sitting all day is not good for you, and it actually kills you. You should not be sitting all day when that's all kids do for 8 hours a day.
I can't believe I had to pay extra for a watch that tells me to stand.
does Minnie Mouse tell you to stand, Chris, on that watch?
Stand up, it's 4:20.
One, school chairs are especially painful. They're just molded plastic and
cheap.
It's super cheap. Well, why would you spend money on children?
I love seeing them thrown out all throughout, like when I'm riding my bike around the city, just because they're two parts.
Yeah, there's no getting rid of them, easily. And that the posturific chairs especially are what I think Merkin and the producers saw of bureaucracy, that they just heard, oh, these chairs will make things better in 1,000 years. Okay, then let's torture children now for 1,000 years to make spines better.
Yeah.
And that it is chilling how real the paralysis is on Milhouse.
Good animation.
And that Edna doesn't care. And that, again, from the last episode, which was a rather grounded story about the running of a school, other than, you know, chasing a dog through air vents, but mostly grounded. Then you have this one, which is a sci-fi hellscape of a school torturing the students.
It is very terrible. And Bart had been tampering with the clock all year with the little bastard clock tampering kit.
Yeah.
And they have to stay after. And Edna is somehow, like, happy about this. I guess she's just happy to punish them.
Yeah, this is a rare episode where Edna prefers hurting the children to doing her job less. Normally, she prefers to do a worse job. And this is the first appearance of Little Bastard.
The debut of Little Bastard Kid.
Though we'll only see it three other times because the Little Bastard thing was... Merkin really liked it, but I don't think anybody else did because it wasn't kept around. The Little Bastard Kit was used by Barthead in Itchy and Scratchy Land.
All right.
And then the...
It's like the traveling kit.
And then in the Joy of Sect,
right,
there are two Little Bastards. Bart tries to Little Bastards the Movementarians, but they get him back with their own Little Bastard
kit. I had one. We made ourselves a Little Bastard Kit. My friend who hadn't seen The Simpsons thought it was the most amazing name I'd ever given anything, but it was filled with glass cutters. Suction cups, a wiretap. His dad had money.
Were you
was
part
like,
of like an art thievery ring? Like what's happening?
He was like an aspiring like Quentin Tarantino-esque hitman and thief as a little boy. And like, it's like to break into stuff. Still a good friend.
Seeing the word bastard on screen as a kid made it more impactful than just if they had said it out loud. Like, well, they wrote a swear on screen.
We did hear the bastard song in
Herb Powell
episode. Herb, not Herb. What am I saying?
And then Bart is distracted by seeing Freddie Quimby first introduced outside the window and writes a note to get away, which Edna should have just called him out on it right then instead of just letting him go. Then we have a cute little Batman 66 reference of them with the crime computer.
Yeah, actually, it's funny that in the previous episode, Skinner gets in hot water for not trusting a child's word on something. So
that's
I guess this is why they want to make sure.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they want to make doubly sure.
Well, they probably had like a lawsuit over Weinstein's parents.
Yom Kippur.
They also reveal more to the sci-fi hellscape thing that Martin implanted a thing in his brain.
Yes, he's just like, happily sitting there while this thing is beeping.
Voluntarily.
Yeah.
Again, it's impossible for me to not view this next to Sweet Seymour Skinner because it was on my tape next to it. So you see Martin go from a kid who would bake cookies for his teacher and be a suck-up in that way to like to have elective brain surgery.
So the school knows where he is,
It is such a big difference. And then we get a cute scene of Good Cop, Bad Cop with Lisa.
I love this.
Spill it! Where's your brother?
You'd better answer him, Lisa. He's a bad man. What are you laughing about?
You started off as the bad cop, and now you're the good one. You and Willie got mixed up about 10 minutes ago.
We did not. Now where's Bart? You better tell me.
Oh, you better tell him, Lassie. I cannot control him when he gets like this.
Now you're the good cop.
What?
I like how the scene ends with just him saying, what?
And I was I was cringing. I'm like, because obviously we do the show and try and figure out what everything's a reference to. And I was like, don't put Lisa in a Basic Instinct reference.
Oh,
don't do that.
No,
don't do that. Because it's framed like that for almost a second.
Willie would do that later.
We'd get that from Willie in just 1 year.
Yeah.
I don't even know if Basic Instinct was out at this point.
It was.
I mean, but not for them to have put it in production.
They made fun of the movie that Sharon Stone did after that in Burns' Air, Sliver. So,
And also on The Critic, they did do in their first episode, their first jokes is the beaver shot.
Can we get a shot
of that? Bart is mortgaging his future happily, and we get some pretty well done scary hobos. Like those are some terrifying hobos who want to show Bart a dead body.
I always thought of that line, mortgaging my future, whenever I had to sign up for a new student loan.
Oh,
it's like
is it funny, Bob?
I can. It will never be funny. I'm in a lot of financial pain. Thank you for giving us money, by the way.
Yes, thanks everybody. I would think of it whenever I would just like, man, I'm not going to do that project. I'll do that project tomorrow. I'll do that as a student in school.
Let future Bob deal with that. I fucking hate that guy.
Well, I always mortgaged my future as a student. I'm smarter than Bart, but I was just as lazy. And I think maybe that was... It was the gifted kid curse that didn't happen to every kid in my gifted classes, but I had that feeling like, well, okay, I'm gifted. I'm smart. I don't have to do this project now. I bet if I just did it tomorrow or if I wrote this thing right before school, it'll be just as good. I'll play a video
game. I learned
that
lesson too.
It happened to me. My parents put me on too much of an accelerated course before school, and I got used to not paying attention, and I didn't have to pay attention until about sixth grade. By then, I didn't know how. It was bad. Fuck you, Mom and Dad.
So on his day off, Bart does a lot of stuff. He goes to see the Boobarama Triple Feature. And Skinner is on his trail, right?
I like that despite him being more savage in this episode than he was in the previous one, he is just as much of a square, and it leads to one of my favorite lines ever.
Why, there are no children here at the 4-H Club either. Am I so out of touch? No, it's the children who are wrong.
I think that's rightfully the most enduring line from this episode. It's not my favorite, I found. I thought it would be. I love it.
It's definitely one of the best lines in the show of all time, I think.
Well, and it sums up... It's why it's become a meme, because it sums up things so perfectly. Mm-hmm. You're just like, is it wrong that I don't know who this Disney star is, or that the kids didn't watch this remake of a thing I liked? No. It's a children.
I always think of that when comedians get really cranky about how certain people don't think certain jokes are funny anymore, and they make giant movies about it. Just like, no, you're old now and you're out of touch. It happens to everybody.
Yeah,
welcome to the ride.
Yeah, I feel like if they would worship George Carlin, but I bet George Carlin probably had a moment like, oh, that's not for me anymore. Like, why? Why would I complain about this new TV show? It's not for me. Like, I don't care.
I'm of two minds of it. Yes, it is a barometer and a constant reminder for content creators like myself that your audience is kind of never wrong. But also, yes, they are sometimes. Yes, they are. Because if you didn't appreciate Don Rickles in 2017 before we lost him, you were wrong.
I appreciate it.
You were wrong. Not you. I'm saying the kids. The children,
the children are right, and we're turning this into talking Minecraft starting next year, so look out for that.
Well,
all
know,
about Undertale coming this fall.
So the 4-H Club is still around, by the way.
No, it's not.
According to Wikipedia.
Holy shit. What are the 4-H's?
Okay,
art,
so,
handwriting.
So the 4-H Club is a... It was a very wholesome club started decades and decades ago to help craft children into better adults and to help them find themselves and just build character.
It's like a free after school program?
Kinda, yeah. And there, according to Wikipedia, 6.5 million members in 2007.
Wow.
And it's in 50 different countries. And the 4-H's of it, I was going to do the whole pledge, but it is like 30 words long. I'm not reading that.
Let's skip it.
The 4-H's are committed to head, heart, hands, and health. As in, you want to be smarter, you want to be more caring, you want to get hands-on in building things to help your community, and you need to be healthier. So,
And single out paraplegics. Problematic, I call it.
It's just like, you failed at health, paraplegics.
What about decapitees?
What about the amputees of the world? That's just sad. I mean,
or children with heart conditions.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm so upset.
So we get a kind of a gross scene where Skinner tastes Bart's gum.
Yes.
And again, like, if there's a word I don't get, if there's a reference I need to look into,
yeah,
I always do it.
Yeah, what's the deal with that?
When Skinner finds Bart's gum, he says, a spore. That he uses the word spore.
Yeah.
And I had to look it up and go on like two pages of Google to find what spore meant, because I've seen this episode 50 times. I didn't know what spore was, or maybe I misheard it.
But
a spore.
Not S-P-O-R-E?
S-P-O-O-R.
Okay.
It's a track, a trail, a scent, or droppings,
holy
especially
shit.
Of a wild animal. So,
whoa!
So Skinner is tracking Bart like an animal, like picking up his leavings.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Wow. I had no clue.
Yes.
I had no clue that
it was
what it meant.
Groundbreaking, eye-opening for me. I didn't even know he said the word spore, but I always have the captioning on now when I watch these to make sure.
Oh, I have a couple secret things I found, too, is that in the auction scene where Bart is pranking the auction, one, there are two Franks listed on the wall of like the auction names, and that two, sitting behind Bart next to the other guy who will run away who is pranking the auction is Joey Jojo Jr. Shabadoo.
Shabadoo.
Man, that guy gets around.
Holy shit.
I mean, obviously they just dug a design out of their garbage.
But I'm sure he's all over the place. We need to look for him now. We have to do a Joey Jojo watch in every episode.
Hey, Joey Jojo!
Joey Jojo!
That could be the alarm if we find a Joey Jojo.
That's awesome. All right.
I love being able to say this in 2017. I thought all the Skinner tracking jokes were Terminator 2.
Me too. Mm-hmm.
And I had not seen the Michael Crichton movie Westworld.
Same here. Yes,
and I love being able to say that in 2017 because more people might get what that is now.
We do have one more thing I want to explore, though, which I don't think anyone will get now. I don't even think they use this jingle or this tagline, or if the gum... I think the gum still exists, but double mint gum. Like, you want to double your pleasure, Bart.
You got a goddamn clip.
Yeah, you want to double your pleasure, Bart, I'll double your detention.
It was really good line.
Yes, so this gum was invented...
If only someone had heard it.
This gum was invented in 1915, but the Twin Base ad started in 1939. I thought this was invented in the 80s because we just watched Spaceballs live on Laser Time, and there's an ad about the Double Mint Twins, chew your gum. You know, he's hanging out with two hot twins. Mm-hmm.
So I never read that joke. Yeah. Double mint line.
So it was a standard twin reference, like, for a long time.
I mean, in the secret sexuality of these ads is like two girls at once, eh?
Yeah.
Chew that gum, buddy. So here's one of the earlier ones from the 60s.
Here's a tip you'll appreciate. It pays to have a smile that's bright to help you look and feel just right.
Double your pleasure, double your fun with double good double mint gum.
I resent this, Bob, because this is... I came to the table to get my favorite Double Mint commercial.
Oh!
I'm going to update this with a little 90s sass. Double your... That's the one we remember.
This is like 91, probably, right?
Oh, yeah.
No single gum, freshens your mouth like Double Mint.
That's two kinds of mints, folks.
There we go.
And there are sexy twins at the end, as there should be.
You know, but... I'm not into those... Double Mint was not my gum. Well, maybe it was. We just talked about it
on Laser Time when you guys came on for a show about The Simpsons, how The Simpsons changed the world, and we attributed Bart and The Simpsons to the longevity of Butterfinger. And since then, Nestle has announced they're selling it because they don't give a fuck.
They're just selling off that bar.
They're selling off, I think, their candy bars. Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Man.
I was also thinking, you know, the Double Mint gum thing is built around sexuality, the advertising, and also of the cheap stick gum variety.
Yes.
Big Red is like, you're gonna suck face longer with this shit. Cram it in your mouth.
You're right.
Ugly.
I didn't think it was a thing that would be dated. But I watch kids' cartoons, and there are not gum commercials anymore.
Well,
especially a commercial for a 25-cent.
I feel like that Double Mint was old lady gum.
Yeah, that
and
Big
like
Red
juicy fruit,
and
Wrigley's.
Well, I see that as in the 90s, stick-based gum just became boring and old.
Yeah,
and they're like,
not stick.
No,
gum.
No. It's time to have atomic mints that destroy your mouth. That's the 90s. Be cool, the 90s. And now gum is still big, but it's like cups of gum with a candy outside of it. It's not, you're not unraveling gum. And,
or like in the old Tylenol packets for some reason.
Yeah. I like Orbitz.
And the biggest Orbit. News gum related recently was that Sean Spicer guy eats gum every day. And he was told by his doctor, like, it's okay, you can eat gum. He's like, okay, because it's just
easy
a nervous tick he has.
It's
like,
an easy way to burn calories.
Yeah, that's true. And
so Skinner is on Bart's trail, and this is all Westworld stuff.
Yeah.
Yes, like Chris, I thought it was T2.
So did I, but I'd never seen Westworld. And it's great. And I love, if you haven't seen Westworld and you've seen the show, check it out. Because they really fuck with, like, having seen Westworld and watching the first couple episodes of the show, they are really fucking with you.
They want you to think you're getting a remake of the movie.
Yeah.
I haven't seen the show
And
yet,
not to spoil it, but Ed Harris is dressed up like the Yul Brynner nonstop monster.
Yeah.
And that's who Skinner is playing.
Well, so if you haven't seen Westworld, it is Jurassic Park, written by Michael Crichton and directed. Well, you're right.
I think maybe, yeah.
Yeah, so Michael Crichton was a filmmaker in Hollywood in the 70s, and he made a film, Westworld, about Disney World for adults, except now the rides are going to kill you.
Well, they malfunctioned, and Yul Brynner is embodied by Yul Brynner, the T-Rex.
Yul Brynner plays a robot of himself, which is so great.
Yeah, and Itchy and Scratchy Land in the next year's episodes. That's
totally.
Jurassic Park meets Westworld.
Yep.
Yes, yeah, and that...
Oh, and the movie contains the debut of a Pixar animation. There's a hand on the wall that's a 3D model, and that's Pixar's first public animation,
But that Westworld is an amazing film that I... Minor spoilers for the movie Westworld, but what I love about it is once the robots malfunction, and they're always supposed to lose, and they can't kill you.
Yeah.
And then Yul Brynner says, draw. And then James Brolin, who is the handsome actor who you figure, well, this is the star of the movie, if anyone is. He is shot and killed, and then his friend is like, wait, no, you're not supposed to, what, like, just him realizing what's wrong, and then Yul Brynner again going, draw. And, yeah, so once it enters Endgame, Skinner poses like the Yul Brynner robot who is slowly walking after the scared little mousy dude who is being chased.
They do a great job of animating him as an intimidating robotic figure, just him scaling the cliff with dead eyes.
A graceful Frankenstein.
And again, after humanizing him so much in the last episode, they dehumanize him entirely.
He's literally a robot now.
He becomes a robot. It's also, I feel like, a little flavor of Terminator 1 style Terminator is in there too, especially when Bart is leaving the ice cream shop and sees the person. It reminds me more of when somebody turns and sees a Terminator, like, oh shit, I gotta run. The one thing that annoyed me in this episode, the one thing I didn't like, and it will last is less than a second, but it's that when Bart turns the corner to run away from Skinner, he will end up at the bridge. But to connect those two, they pull out two scenes of Bart running just to get him that distance away. They're like, well, wait, I can see how they did it. They're like, no, in this animation, he's in town, and then he's in the middle of nowhere the next second. You have to do something. So they take a shot of Bart running from dogs, from Dog of Death's in Burns' backyard, and then Bart running down a mountain from a boulder in Camp Krusty.
That's funny. I didn't pick up on the Dog of Death animation. Mm-hmm. I definitely picked up on the Camp Krusty, because it's so out of place. Yeah. Bart looks a little different, and he's not acting the right way, and he's like just... I mean, I remember the scene. The boulder is about to crush him.
Yeah.
Like he's running from a boulder.
But that the Dog of Death one is so brief, or it might be from Thanksgiving. It's one of the two times
it's
he runs.
Dog of Death.
Okay. It's less than a second. They both want them to just be subliminal to tell you Bart got somewhere else and we couldn't animate a new thing, but it's so distracting of seeing even season 3 animation or looks completely out of place in season 5.
But before we find out Skinner is some sort of non-giving up school guy, Homer and Bart run into each other. They're both playing hooky.
Can't let Dad see me playing hooky.
I can't let the boys see me skipping work.
Good afternoon.
How do you do, sir?
Sucker.
I think they just think they fooled each other when they fooled no one.
Yes.
And then Homer, it's the only scene Homer has until halfway through the episode, but it's a very funny scene. And
he holds a comb in front of his nose as a mustache. How do you do, sir?
I do love that non-giving up school guy line.
Oh my god, he is like some sort of non-giving up school guy.
He's finally got Bart, and it's kind of a cheat, but I do like how they at least frame it, that the car... You notice the car, but not enough to know for sure that that's how Bart's going to get away, but it's a good excuse to get Bart away from Skinner.
And Skinner says, I can smell his fear.
Yes. And then, now I was shocked. I feel like they would definitely not do it here where Bart would just pull out a knife with no explanation, like, oh yeah, Bart's got a knife.
I was thinking of that. He won his anti-Donnie Don't badge.
Yeah, I had a pocket knife. I had a pocket knife, and I had a what is it called? Fireman's clip? It's what you get in Boy Scouts when you're authorized to have a knife. I would have had one by this point.
It was yet another example of someone enjoying a knife on The Simpsons.
So we go straight from a Westworld parody into the Kennedy compound, or the Quimby compound, and we get to see rich assholes, and it's really well done, and that shows you too that, like, all these jokes could work with the Trump family now, but it's just about entitled rich families who
control too
much. The
Kennedy family was likable.
They have a lot more charm. The Kennedys have a lot more charm.
But it's still just like kind of tacky new money people and ill-behaved younger members of the family.
I like that Freddie Quimby first says, like, I'm not paying you to talk, which as a kid I did not understand that as an escort line. And so then they end up at the Quimby compound, which is just a straight-up parody of the Kennedy compound, which is located at 100 Marchant Avenue in Hyannisport, Massachusetts. And they've lived there for decades and decades. It's the big family thing. Like, weddings happen there. With the dwindling number of Kennedys left, it's where they did stuff. It was the base of operations for John F. Kennedy when they would do stuff there. But the Quimby compound is today host to Freddie's, like, I forgot it was Freddie's 18th birthday.
That's right,
like,
yeah, he's still really young.
So he's a real piece of shit.
And here's how to know just how bad Freddie Quimby is.
Give me the ball! People, the punch has been spiked.
That's my nephew, displaying the Quimby wit that's won the public's heart. Happy birthday, Freddy! And may all your disgraces be private.
That's Quimby. So, I'm putting this out here now, Henry. Now that we have the Patreon going, I want to do every season a cut episode for mm-hmm. Patreon.
Oh, yes.
Because I've been watching a lot of these in context of the actual episodes, because they're all on the fourth disc. It makes it much easier to watch. Mm-hmm. And there's more specific Kennedy stuff in this episode they cut.
Oh,
in
wow.
In fact, Bart meets a version of Rosemary Kennedy, who was...
You're obsessed with the goddamn Kennedys.
Yes, but she was like the JFK's older sister, aging pretty badly in public, but still attending events. And when Bart meets her, she comes out in that Star Trek-like pod from the first episode of Star Trek.
Oh, my gosh, yes. The Captain Pike's
exactly.
thing. Yes, wow.
Yeah. And Bart asks her a question, and she just answers him with her mouth. Like, there's no reason for her to be in that, but she like comes out hovering in that thing.
That is everything of a 60s child nostalgia right there.
It really
a
is,
Kennedy
yeah.
reference, literally dressed up in a Star Trek reference. That is, well, I mean, you can't not be obsessed with the Kennedys. It's like if you grew up then. They're making, this episode has references to Batman. They'll have all these references to Beatles. Mm-hmm. Beatles, Batman, Kennedys. Like, that was all the 60s.
I mean, Kennedys were sort of American royalty briefly. Or yes, they were working their way towards
that. Well, I think that's
that.
Part, they were cut down.
Yeah.
Well, both of them.
Quite a few of them, yeah.
Well, even in the 90s, before John went mm-hmm. away, which Bart is a reference to John
Bart,
that had to be explained to me.
I did not get that at all.
But the idea of a Kennedy of just saying like, oh, it's a Kennedy, like it still was like, wow, and it had a lot of cachet. It's why it was a huge deal in an episode of Seinfeld of just getting with John and that Jane Leaves would lose her virginity to John Kennedy.
Oh, right.
And the virgin episode.
I forgot about
of
that.
Seinfeld. Yeah, so the Kennedys had a ton of cachet, and obviously Quimby was always a Kennedy joke. Like, Mayor Quimby was always a Kennedy joke.
At first, just his voice, but then they were like, we could do more with this.
And they deepened it every time, but this is the first time you've seen the family of Quimbys that are the Kennedy family.
I mean, we have seen his wife before, who is wearing the pillbox hat and
that
everything.
Is true,
she is Jackie O.
Yeah, but we even get to
next
find out like
is named after Jackie O.
That is so,
more coincidence coming your way.
So that's the... Well, I think that also is what complicates it too, is that they mix up the Kennedy references, that the Bouvier family is, that is the name of, the maiden name of Jackie Onassis Kennedy. And but Bart is so entranced in the Quimby family / Kennedy family that he's even meeting the famous in-laws of the Kennedys.
Hey McBain, I'm a big fan, but your last movie really sucked.
I know. There were script problems from day one.
Yeah, I'll say. Magic ticket my ass, McBain.
Maria, my mighty heart is breaking. I'll be in the Humvee.
God, you really see Wiggum roast someone like that.
Yes.
Magic ticket my ass, McBain.
But a really blurred line in the Rainier Wolfcastle.
So first off, they're not calling him Rainier Wolfcastle. Yeah. They are calling him McBain, which they couldn't do McBain parodies anymore at this time, or they were told not to.
What a weird choice.
Right, they were.
I mean,
yeah, because the McBain movie, like the producers didn't want to do it, but they were told by Fox overhead, like, no, there is a movie called McBain coming out now, so you can't have McBain movie things. But like, but we had them first.
I think that this fictional Last Action Hero parody is a McBain movie in the Simpsons universe, and Wiggum is calling him by his character's name.
Well, so, but that also means within the Simpsons universe, there is no Arnold Schwarzenegger, except there is because he becomes the Secretary of State. No, he becomes fucking president. Sorry.
Yeah.
So in this point, there is no Arnold Schwarzenegger in the Simpsons universe. So then Rainier Wolfcastle starred in The Last Action Hero, which, in case you didn't know what the magic ticket refers to.
I love this fucking
movie.
Here's
the thing. I think, like Waterworld, this became a really easy punching bag for the media to hit. And it's not as bad as people say
it's such a different time in media, and I know I'm fucking being nostalgic, but like, where even bombs had like resonance in the zeitgeist.
Yeah,
this is a movie no one saw. I love this film.
I think it was all like Schadenfreude because Schwarzenegger didn't have a flop.
Yeah, not yet.
This really, I mean, even fucking Jim Belushi movies he was in were doing well.
I think around like before Jim Carrey is rising up this year, he was one. Him and Mel Gibson were the highest paid actors in Hollywood. Record paychecks. I remember all these newspapers couldn't stop breaking down how much he got paid for. How by the word in T2, because he says barely anything.
Oh, God.
I mean, he's the work is his muscles. It's something they don't talk about with like movie stars and they just see them on screen, you're like, you know, they had to work out for 6 months to do this.
But this
like,
I love Last Action Hero. It is the JCVD being John Malkovich of Arnold Schwarzenegger. He plays this meta version of himself. Yes. Arnold Schwarzenegger is in the movie.
It was released the previous summer, too, so they had plenty of time to make fun of it.
So, but specifically a magic ticket.
Jack Slater 4.
But tonight, a magic ticket.
It's a passport to another world.
Will get Danny closer to the action than anyone ever dreamed.
Oh, this is really dumb.
Holy cow! I'm in the movie!
It's a little kid is warped into an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, and then Arnold is warped out.
Yes. Well, so first he lives... It is really funny as a meta film.
It's really cool.
Taken by itself.
What, his ex-partner is Danny DeVito as a cartoon cat?
Yes, but he just accepts it. And in that world, Stallone is
Stallone
Terminator.
Is Arnold.
And they go to... Like, that's what I just love in the movie, too. Mm-hmm. That he lives in a movie world, so the kid just goes like, okay, all the phone numbers are 555. He's like, oh, there's area codes. He's like, okay, let's go to a Blockbuster in this world and see what movies are on shelves.
Yeah, it feels like this was written for Roger Ebert, because he used to write those books full of like things that only happen in movies, and they were always really fun to read. But I'll tell you why this movie was a bomb. Jurassic Park opened June 11th. Oh. This movie opens June 13th. Basically, if you're not Jurassic Park, fuck you. In the summer of 93. You're doomed.
That movie spent a year in theaters, people. Cannot underemphasize how successful
Jurassic
Park was.
There was no avoiding Jurassic Park, but it was also like... It came at a time, I think, when people wanted Arnold to fail at something. Or also, it turned into this inverse thing where they spent so much money on ads. Mm-hmm. So very many. And I think when people can... I think when the mainstream audiences can tell you want it to be a hit, and it doesn't feel organic, then you go like, oh, then I'm not buying this. Which is different from, like... Jurassic Park obviously had tons of fucking marketing behind it, but it felt more natural than just like, oh, the Last Action Hero toys are on shelves before the movie is out.
But it was an anxiously awaited, based on a bestseller from someone with, let's say, the best pedigree in all the film, whereas this didn't have that cachet. Mm-hmm. It was just, Arnold can't fail. Let's make the silliest thing we can think of.
Ultimately, this was not a flop in terms of profit. Budget, $85 million, kind of pricey for a movie in 93, but the box office returns, $137 million. So it could have made more money. They probably thought it was going to be like a huge movie, but it still didn't lose them money.
Batman for Arnold.
Well, that budget does not take into account the massive amounts of marketing they did.
I mean, I'm sure the SNES game turned a tidy profit, right?
They literally launched an ad into space for this movie.
Oh,
they really did do that.
I think this had to be in every video game magazine, every comic book. Yeah. It's like, you're this kid. You're going to have fun with Arnie.
I wondered who was going to be the first to mention it, because that's what I remember about it.
The film was also built to be like, this is a PG-13 action film. You can finally really market to kids instead of having like parent groups say, Terminator 2 shouldn't be marketed to kids. It's an R-rated movie.
In other words, not what Arnold fans wanted.
No, they want him to blow people's brains out. Though Arnold was getting into PG-13 at this time anyway. Like, he had the rule in T2 of, like, I don't kill cops. Like, I'm a good guy now and I don't murder people. Mm. Which is a stark contrast to Terminator 1, where he
murders everybody.
And my last thing about Last Action Hero, I'll say, is that my friend growing up, his name was Charlie... I made friends with him after this movie came out, but he, for real, 98% the same look as the kid in the movie. He looked same haircut and everything.
It's
but
a very popular 93 boys haircut.
It was. Yes, yeah. And, consult my girl, too, for more.
Rainier Wolfcastle was there with a woman named Maria. Obviously, Maria Shriver, Arnold Schwarzenegger's former wife.
No, they're still married.
They're separated now.
Are they? Oh,
my bad. He dipped his mop in the house mop bucket, and that's a no-no. And he has some illegitimate children, right?
Well, ridiculous as it seemed at the time and now seems all too normal, Arnold Schwarzenegger became the governor of California and was the governor of California from 2003 to 2011. He would likely be our president now were it not for the Constitution. Mm.
The premise of the Simpsons movie is sort of like, isn't it crazy that this guy is the president? And we don't have to say anything.
And honestly, I've heard people argue like, if he had gone against Trump, he would have destroyed Trump. He would have been like, oh, you're insulting all these other all these other politicians. I am also a celebrity and can insult you
worse. I can
worse.
Make fun of you, and I'm educated.
Yes. Yeah, he married Maria. She was the first lady of California for those 8 years.
And she was the host of the Today Show?
Well, so she is a journalist. She is the niece of John F. Kennedy.
Yes. Right.
And that she was a journalist on the Today Show, and Maria Shriver was her name, and that then she married Arnold in the 80s. Like, they had been together for a very long time, and it was just a thing of, like, if you saw her on the Today Show, you'd say, oh, that's Arnold's wife. Mm-hmm. And she was the first lady of California. They perhaps made the decision to not get separated while he was governor. But within months of him leaving the governor's mansion, they were separated.
Yeah.
And it came out that he had illegitimate children who were like 16 in their teens, who with the help, with their domestic helpers. And so it was just like, and so they are officially divorced. She now lives in one of their old houses.
That's
but like,
good.
She's a fucking Kennedy. She doesn't need Schwarzenegger's money. Like,
I do like Arnold more than most Republicans, but that does feel like a strange power relationship. Yeah. You know, just be like, I could sleep with anyone in this house. I'm Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Very House of Cards.
Yeah. Yes.
And don't cheat on my wife.
So yeah, Maria, she's back in the news to a lesser extent. She still does it, like, when she feels like doing it. But so she's referred to on the wiki as Maria Quimby, but I don't, that wouldn't actually fit. Like, Maria, her name should be different, like
Wolf
Shriver's.
Castle.
Yeah, well, oh, she didn't become Maria Schwarzenegger. She was always Maria Shriver, whose father was a different name than Kennedy.
Right,
so
it was Kennedy's sister's child.
Yeah. So then Maria, then she shouldn't be Maria Quimby. I know this is really digging into the particulars of
what you're paying for, people.
But that Maria Quimby had been divorced from Rainier Wolfcastle in the universe at one point in the episode in whatever season it was, where Bart's dating the daughter of Rainier Wolfcastle, and it is revealed that, like, he's splitting her time with her mother, so they're divorced. But then in the 2007 episode where Homer becomes a paparazzi and he basically works for J. Jonah Jameson, which I love.
Oh, right.
J.K. Simmons plays the editor-in-chief of it.
That's great. I forgot about that choice.
Homer takes a photo of him with his wife, with Rainier and Maria together. So apparently they got back together in 2007. She has not made an appearance since then. We have talked for 17 minutes on this one joke, but the last thing I want to say is that I think that joke is the writer saying that, like, in real life, Arnold Schwarzenegger does not give a shit that you can make fun of him and that he made a bad movie that failed.
Oh, yeah.
So they go to the other extreme of just like, my mighty heart is breaking.
I'll be in the Humvee.
So
yeah.
Arnold Schwarzenegger probably does not, like, he probably didn't care. He probably went to the next movie he was going to do.
Mm-hmm. So we're at the end of what I think is the longest first act of a Simpsons episode. When it ended, I paused my DVD. And it was like half over. The episode was half over. It's like an 11-minute first act.
It is over 9 minutes long. Yes, and that it. I think it has to be the longest first act they ever did. But that's when Freddie Quimby finds something very funny, and I just love how good the animation is here of everyone else being just uncomfortable.
Hey, what the hell is this?
It's a bowl of Shadale, sir.
Wait a minute. Come here. What did you call it? Say it loud enough so everyone can hear. Come on, say it.
Shaudel.
Shaudel. Shaudel. It's chowder. Say it right.
Shaudel.
Come back here. I'm not through demeaning you.
God, he's so cruel and childish. Yeah. And that waiter's name, we find out later, is Mr. Lacoste.
Oh.
And Lacoste is a famous brand of clothing, famous for the little alligator embroidery on it. And it was actually a French company that started making clothes for tennis.
Yes.
So it's a cheap French joke, in other words.
It is. Well, he is a cheap French joke in general.
Yeah, that's true.
He's like, I am the French waiter. I am so hot. It's impressive, too, that Castellaneta can do two distinctively Quimby voices, but that are separate too. Like you can.
Freddie's
tell
a little more nasal.
I'm not through demeaning you.
Not through demeaning you. His voice is very similar to the JFK of Clone High as well. They're pretty much the same dude, which I love. The Clone High is one of my favorite. I hope to someday we do an episode about Clone High.
It's a fun voice to do.
Yes.
The Simpsons will be right back.
Hi, diddly ho, listenerinos. It's Henry Gilbert here, thanking you for listening to 100 episodes of Talking Simpsons. I'm assuming you listened to all of them. You have, right? Well, if you like this so much and you want to hear episodes a week early and want to hear tons of bonus things, including interviews with people who worked on classic Simpsons video games, the first episodes of Talking Critic, and much, much more, there's such an easy way to do that. Just go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. That's right. Bob and Henry have launched a Patreon to put all their exclusive Simpsony goodness in one place, and as a way to help them do it full time. Just $5 a month will get you access to so many things, and $10 will give you even more cool access to upcoming exclusive stuff. Help us hit our next goal, and we might just do a whole new publicly available podcast about every animated show, one episode at a time. You heard that right. You can find out more details at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. And again, thanks all of you so very much for listening. Here's to 100 more. No, 600 more. Yeah!
Hey, this is Hank Azaria. You're listening to Talking Simpsons on Laser Time. I didn't know that was a thing.
You like Laser Time shows? Then you might like Bonus Time, Laser Time's weekly bonus show exclusively on patreon.com/lasertime. Here's a taste of what you've been missing.
My weekend did have some fun moments of taking a surprise trip with my mom up to my Uncle Eric's place. And my strategy of not telling her I quit my job to not let her worry.
Even though she subscribed to your podcast?
Yes, look, I realized how stupid it was, okay?
I was the coward. My mom was visiting, and I didn't tell her.
Yeah.
Basically, I ran the idea by her, and I was like, if I quit my job to do podcasting, what would you think? And she says, I think you could make smart decisions, and I trust you to do that. And I was like, okay, I still won't tell you, but you'll find out later when you're not here. I guess my parents just don't ask me questions. They don't understand what writing about video games is. They don't understand what podcasting is. Yeah. They just understand I can make a living off of it somehow.
I haven't asked my parents for money in years, and I told them what it was, and like, and they've never asked again.
My parents are still asking the same two questions every time they call. How is your job going? And if, as long as I say okay and I don't need money, then they're fine. And what time is it over there?
Oh my god, Dave, I was thinking that exact thing.
Still 3 hours ahead.
Whenever my mom calls me, I've been living here for 6 years. What time is it there? They're just so like amazed by the time difference. It's great.
It's minus two.
Three.
We're on the metric time system now, and I can't tell you more.
Get Bonus Time, Laser Time's weekly, full-length, uncensored, and ad-free Patreon-exclusive podcast, as well as full-length movie commentaries, wrestling and cartoon video commentaries, the first season of Talking Simpson, and more at patreon.com/lasertime, starting at just $5. You'll help us live, and we'll do our best to help you never be bored again.
The sound of him getting smashed around, which we will later find out is him just falling around, I wish it was exactly the same as clip we'll see later, but it's just to get more jokes in it later, but to speed it up at first. Him putting his hand in the egg beater is not represented in the sound, and the boiling water falling on his head is not represented in the sound.
Okay, yeah, those seem like new additions at the end, but what strikes me as funny is that in production season 5, not season 5 what aired, production season 5, there's no Sideshow Bob episode. This is the one mystery episode of the season. Like, what happened to the waiter? Only Bart knows. And apparently Freddie Quimby didn't do it. I've seen this episode 50 times, so I know what happened every time I go back to it, but when you're watching it for the first time, you're like, what did happen if Freddie Quimby didn't beat him?
It's a good trail to leave for you and to follow. And the giant Rice Krispie square, that was pretty cool. Like that
just seems so impractical. How do you serve that thing?
Well, and that's such a like cheap thing too, but it's just big. Like, well, what would a rich person have at normal people's parties except giant?
Make sure it's huge.
And I bet they changed the line to in the ADR, but I love that Wiggum first notices the bite taken out of the Rice Krispie square. So,
and the waiters are brutally beaten.
So right next to him is a guy wearing, it is not the face of Freddie Quimby, but he is wearing the same clothes and he has a drink in his hand, which is what Freddie Quimby left to do. Do you think that that person was supposed to be Freddie Quimby there? So if you went back and watched it, you see Freddie Quimby enter the room, thus giving him an alibi that you wouldn't notice at first.
You know what? Maybe. I can't tell what the intention was on that. They don't mention it in the commentary, you know. We don't see Freddy again in the Quimby estate after that happens. So.
But it just looks like off-model of the Freddy they'd shown.
It could be just
point.
A related Quimby. I assume that Freddy storms off with the bottle. I'm going to enjoy this! And then he walks off.
He wouldn't even pour it into a glass, actually. No, he was just drinking it straight up.
He was.
Which, by the way, he's breaking the law. He's 18.
He's rich and can get away with it.
As Marge would say when she finds out the news.
It says Freddie Quimby beat a waiter half to death. Those Quimby children are so wild and rich. I hope he finally gets what's coming to him.
But Freddie Quimby's innocent.
How do you know? There weren't any witnesses.
Oh, yeah, right.
You'd think someone would have seen something at a crowded party like that.
Well, they didn't, okay? They didn't. It says right here in black and white, no witnesses. Case closed. Let's all read the funnies. Oh, look, Charlie Brown said good grief. Huh, I didn't see that coming.
I'm glad in hindsight, I thought that was them taking peanuts down a peg, but it is not.
No, I guess not. I mean, it is... It's more a joke on the repetitiveness of comic strips.
They had a thing for making fun of lame comic strips. I would assume they had more respect for Peanuts, but this does feel like that is a very Peanuts thing that would happen. The saying of
I
good grief.
I just assume Bart wasn't actually reading it.
He was remarking upon something very unremarkable, like, oh, look, Garfield said I hate Mondays again. Isn't that great? Yeah.
It's not, Garfield would work better there than Charlie Brown, but the... It's not exact same joke construction as the Homer, oh, Andy Cap, you wife-beating drunk, or that he just sees Marmaduke is the funniest thing in the world. It's not
Rex
the
Morgan,
same
MD.
Joke.
Yes, yeah, you've got the cure for my daily blues. The daily blues.
I love the headline, too, that is Chowder Said Wrong.
Chowder Said Wrong.
Though, actually, this was the first time I noticed this kind of inconsistency.
Uh-oh.
So Wiggum arrests Freddie Quimby right there. Like, based on the photo, they arrested him at the event. But if they did that, like, that seems crazy to me that the mayor would invite the easily bribable Wiggum to his party and then let him just arrest the guest of honor. He would have just told him, like, you're not arresting anybody.
I mean, I think Wiggum saw as one. He was so full of just hubris and confidence after telling off McBain. So he saw as one chance to, like, I could bust a Quimby.
No, that's true. Yeah. But it's interesting how they introduced the fact that Bart knows he didn't do it with that line there. That just, like, no, he's innocent. And it's a nice, like, slow burn until he can finally admit to Lisa that he knows what really happened, and that I think it's kind of cute that he can befriend Lisa in this, and he brings her into the conference.
I do like when they work together.
You're a witness? Bart, you have to tell the police.
I can't.
Why?
Bart Simpson, I know you cut school yesterday, and as soon as I can prove it, I'm shipping you off to the Christian Military Reform School.
What he said.
Oh, I see. If you testify, Skinner will know you skipped school. Well, if Freddie Quimby didn't do it, I'm sure he'll be found innocent by a fair and impartial jury.
Oh, jury duty! I'll see that Quimby kid hang for this!
I knew it was a bad idea to watch him open the mail.
That was a great, very great Merkin-y touch. Just like, why would they be there?
As a kid, the idea of a Christian military reform school just sounded terrifying to me.
Like, it's a great joke because it's all the three kinds of schools children were threatened with to be sent to. Like, Samantha from Bart's Friend Falls in Love was sent to a Christian school, but you also hear, you're going to go to military school, or you're going to go to reform school. This is Christian military reform school. All the three worst descriptors for school.
The most
I went to Catholic school. Don't comment.
And then that Skinner is just so petty and mean this entire thing. He's like, no, you missed one day of school. I will destroy you.
I forgot everything I learned in the last episode, Bart.
Yes. I mean, he's sticking to his guns. He said they'd have to be enemies again, and he meant it.
Old Donald Duck cartoons led me to believe there were truant officers, people whose job it was to bus kids skipping school.
Truant, they'll say. Mm-hmm. Clearly, the government cut back on those truant officers.
And the opening mail, I missed that joke 1,000 times. Yes. And then, like, immediately the next one, I'd never noticed before now.
Let's go over to the county courthouse live to Kent Brockman.
Ackman, just outside the county courtroom where an argument about chowder has spilled over into the biggest trial in Springfield history. Behind these doors, a federal judge will ladle out steaming bowls of rich, creamy justice in a case the media have dubbed Beat Up Waiter. This reporter suggested Waitergate, but was shouted down at the press club. Now it's illegal to televise court proceedings in this state, so we'll have to be quiet. No!
All that is so great, but my favorite is just the delay in the live feed. Ackman.
Yeah, so Waitergate is a really great term, and I'm mad. I'm also mad with Kent. They didn't use it. Beat up waiter.
That joke feels like a joke on joke writing. The pettiness of a writer in the Simpsons writers' room, per se, who's like, my joke was better. You used beat up waiter. That's not as funny as Waitergate.
Waitergate's great.
Like, you can hear it in the commentary sometime where I think it was somebody complaining that David X. Cohen thought up of Embiggen or Cromulent, and he's like, no, Embiggen's better. You stole my thunder with Cromulent.
I'm glad they use both.
Yeah, they're both great, but that. And yes, the very live feeling of, like, Ackman here.
That's actually a reference to an old bit by the comedians Bob and Ray.
Oh!
And it's Bob Elliott playing Wally Ballou, a reporter, and every time they cut to him, he's delayed by a second. So it's like, Ballou here with blah, blah, blah. So this is Jane Curtin introducing him. This is from, like, a Lorne Michaels-produced video with, like, Gilda Radner and Jane Curtin and a few other people, and Bob and Ray for some reason. They're, like, in their 70s here. And Bob Elliott only makes boxes. I mean, that the voice of the Box Factory guy is Bob Elliott.
Since this is a live broadcast, the Finley News team is able to bring you up-to-the-minute, fast-breaking stories. Our crack correspondent, Wally Ballou, winner of 13 Diction Awards, two of which were cufflinks, was in Times Square today and had this report. So come in, please, Wally Ballou.
Lee Ballou here at Times Square for the fast-breaking news story that may take...
I love Bob Elliott's voice.
It's Chris Elliott's dad, you might know from Get a Life.
Who worked with David Merkin quite a lot.
And he just passed away.
Did he really?
Just passed away. Part of the legacy of Elliott comedians, there's Bob Elliott, his son Chris Elliott, and Chris Elliott's daughter, Abby Elliott.
Abby Elliott.
And did you like the brief return of Scott Christian?
Yeah.
That could have been anybody throwing to Brockman, but it was Scott Christian, which... That was a season one runner, which, hey, listen to it on the Patreon if you haven't yet. But it was the season one runner that you would never see Kent Brockman. It would be the evening news with Kent Brockman, then Scott Christian filling in for Kent Brockman. So they kind of followed that with just like, he's not, if Kent is not there, Scott Christian fills in.
That's right, and I like that he is back. But
and that Brockman, he recognizes that you can't film in courtrooms, but he's like, so we're just going to cheat. So it is crazy that this episode is airing around when we will get the O.J. Simpson trial. Not yet.
We're still like a month and a half away, or a month away, actually.
Nicole Simpson is still enjoying life at this point, but that... We're about to have it, but this feels like a Simpson parody, a Simpson trial parody, rather.
A very prescient parody of it.
I mean, the Menendez trial was pretty much warm-up for the media for the O.J. trial.
Yeah, and another one they'll mention in this episode, actually. This next scene is the You Can Read My Thoughts scene. What I love about it, God bless the director, Jeffrey Lynch, who is great. Mm-hmm. This scene requires them to hold on like a still image for a long time. And this is the funniest Skinner has been drawn and the funniest Homer has been drawn. Just these still images are just so great. So much emotion packed into their faces.
I know you can read my thoughts, Bart. Just a little reminder. If I find out you cut class, your ass is mine. Yes, you heard me. I think words I would never say.
I know you can read my thoughts, boy. Meow, 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 meow.
Bart is showing off his shinning, and we hear Macarena as the courtroom artist sketching away. So, this is the Homer singing the Meow Mix commercial ad jingle, and this has been around since the 70s.
It's my favorite thing, and I never really saw the commercial, but in the movie that I loved as a child, Hot to Trot, that's shown like twice, I would laugh every time.
And I think Mike Myers sings it as Dr. Evil to Mr. Bigglesworth.
That's right.
So I looked up online, there's like a 15-minute compilation of all of the Meow Mix commercials to date. Mm-hmm. I chose the Close Encounters of the Third Kind parody, the cat is singing the Meow Mix jingle to the spaceship that's repeating it back. And if you know Close Encounters of the Third Kind, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. If you know the movie, you'll get the parody, but it soon goes into the Meow Mix jingle you know and love.
Wow.
Let it go.
Meow, meow, meow.
brand cat food has the three flavors cats love best and tastes so good it's become a universal favorite.
Yes, that is the greatest thing I've ever seen.
I know. You love it, Chris. So the spaceship from Close Encounters, which looks like a 60s Christmas ornament, it floats down and has the Meow Mix jingle lyrics running across it as the cat meows to it.
It's a great name for cat food.
Meow Mix is good. Very alliterative.
It's almost a little cheap to just be like, and then Homer sings a jingle, like, what's the last thing you think he'd be thinking? But just that Meow Mix jingle is so funny to hear. The way Castellaneta does it.
Yeah.
What was really hard with getting clips for this whole episode is just that it's like the last four clips were all just in the same minute. I didn't cut anything from it.
This is all solid gold, this whole courtroom stuff.
The second act is so goddamn strong, and that this was the first time I never got it as a kid. The way he says, I would think the words I would never say, I now finally click like, oh, Skinner would never say ass out loud.
Yeah.
He wouldn't swear, but he's thinking ass, and he kind of breaks it. I feel like I could find a season 8 episode pretty easily.
I'm sure he does.
Yes, where he swears, but it's a thing that any principal in a school would do of just like, well, I can't swear at school. The children. Think of the children. Yeah, and that was Matt Groening. They, just to make it extra obvious, he signs it Matt Groening in the Matt Groening stamp that is on everything he does not draw of The Simpsons.
That's back when his hair wasn't gray.
Yeah.
Brown-haired Matt Groening. And it's probably late 30s at this point, or maybe he's 40.
So isn't it weird that lawyer's voice is blue-haired lawyer, but it's not blue-haired lawyer.
Very strange.
If anybody in the comments knows, like, if this is based on a specific lawyer from a specific court case that they're referencing, or maybe they just wanted to shake things up, like, can't be blue-haired lawyer.
Blue-haired lawyer, at this point, is he exclusively Burns on Burns retainer? Because we've seen him before.
He's the lawyer for any anti-Simpsons cause. Like, anything the good guys are going up against, he will be the lawyer against it.
Yeah, he's even been, like, for the government prosecutor sometimes, it felt like. So, and I guess to see how little money the French waiter has, he has a much worse...
Wait, did we just see Lionel Hutz in the last episode?
Yes. Okay. No, not the last episode. Burns is there. Yeah. We're really using him lightly, but it, 40 seconds of Phil Hartman goes a long way in an episode.
That waiter, Mr. LaCourse, not only wasn't born in Springfield, he wasn't even born in this country.
I'll run the phones.
From now on, you tell me everything.
That one that everybody is shocked that this French waiter wasn't born in America and that they could use. But it's a great parody of how lawyers use people's natural prejudices to win cases, except it's funny when used against a cartoon Clouseau-esque waiter.
He is a great lawyer in that respect.
Yes. Mo would definitely take a bribe, but I don't know why they would want Mo as their character witness. Like, there's a million people that...
Also, why is Wiggum bribing Mo if Wiggum is the one who arrested Freddie Quimby? It's very weird.
Well, that would then seem to imply that Wiggum was pushed to arrest Freddie and he wouldn't have wanted to. Or maybe he's changed his mind and in some smoky backroom meeting with Joe Quimby, he's convinced to do it.
That relationship is over between them, and I love
That's true. This episode could have really used a scene between Quiggum and Wimby talking about what they're going to do in this. But
one other thing, it's funny that, Quimby gives Mo this bribe. Oh, my laundry is here, whatever. Mm-hmm. In the episode Homer the Vigilante, Wiggum was given a bribe by Quimby
time. Here's your monthly kickback.
You
couldn't have picked a worse time.
It's just funny that he sort of didn't learn anything from that situation.
Well, and not only is the blue-haired lawyer not there, but Judge Snyder, is not there either. It's an unnamed woman.
He needed a chick on the bench, Henry.
It's only for that joke. It's the only reason it's not Snyder is for the chicks on the bench joke, which is a pretty great joke.
And the next joke, this required a lot of research, and even I'm not sure if I did enough, but I was doing it for maybe 40 minutes, and there's a lot to digest, and no easy answer, so here's the joke.
You see, Lisa, they don't need my testimony.
Only because Mayor Quimby's buying his nephew's freedom.
The system works. Just ask Claus Von Bulow.
Okie doke. So, Claus Von Bulow, it was a very, very infamous and popular case in the 80s. Mm-hmm. He is a British socialite. He's still alive, and I think he's in his late 80s. Or his 90s. Yeah. Okay, so Claus Von Bulow British socialite. He was tried with the attempted murder of his wife on two consecutive occasions over two consecutive years. So 1979 and 1980, he was accused of attempted murder on his wife. Honestly, is there a Nobel Prize for attempted chemistry? So he was sentenced to 30 years. He appealed the decision, and here's the kicker. His legal team is – this is a great story.
Yeah.
His legal team, Alan Dershowitz, of course, who would later go on to be the defense for O.J. Simpson.
That great innocent man.
And two Harvard Law School students helped out, two people who are very famous today. Mm-hmm. A guy named Jim Cramer, the Mad Money guy, mm-hmm. the guy
what?
Who was on TV. I'm not sure if he still is, but his thing was to, like, he was sort of the morning zoo DJ, but with stocks. Mm-hmm. And he got, like, right before the economic collapse, he got a lot of dumb people to invest in dumb shit, and he was always wrong.
Yep.
And the other guy was Elliot Spitzer.
Yep.
What?
Yeah. Who was mostly known as the first Republican to try to eat his own face after a sex scandal.
Wow.
And, of course, I'm making a joke because if you're caught in a sex scandal...
Stop being political!
If you're caught in a sex scandal and you're photographed or your press conference is filmed, you are trying to chew your own face off. You're like
biting your lip like, I gotta keep pulling my lip into my fur.
You're clenching your entire jaw.
Wow. I completely forgot about Elliot Spitzer because Wiener overshadows him so much now, too.
Yes.
Like, Anthony Weiner is the superstar of those things now. But so both those guys help Claus von Bulow in his appeal, and they win. He's a free man.
Right? Yes. And he's a free... And I can't get what the joke is. Is it like money buys freedom?
That's what I don't understand. So there was a 1990 movie called Reversal of Fortune, mm-hmm. starring Jeremy Zion, we all know the famous actor,
yes.
playing Claus von Bulow. Uh-huh. And when I was reading about this, I couldn't... This is such a complicated case. It wasn't like he's always obviously guilty or always obviously innocent. It's just like... There's so much we don't know, and so much that came out after the fact that it's hard to say, and I'm not sure what this joke is about, but we can play the clip of the trailer for Reversal of Fortune with Jeremy's Iron.
Yeah, because the trial, if you just read it at a wiki glance, it's like, well, the second trial had a ton of... It was about a woman being shot up by too much insulin. Did the husband do it?
Yeah.
And there's three dozen more details that come to light in the second trial, and I can't say whether or not it's bullshit.
Yeah, it's like, oh, they found 30 aspirin in her digestive system and stuff like that. So, yeah, here is that's going to pick up in the middle of the trailer with him talking to the legal team and stuff.
Until his own family accused him of trying to kill her. Now, a world-renowned Harvard lawyer.
I should tell you that I have the greatest respect for the intelligence and integrity of the Jewish people.
I'm not a hired gun.
It's the Dersh.
I gotta feel there's some moral or constitutional issue at stake.
But I'm absolutely innocent.
And a team of law students.
We have to completely obliterate every single aspect of the state's case.
Are the only ones who believe in him.
Klaus is a scapegoat.
He's obviously guilty of something pretty despicable.
Insolent.
Because almost everyone else believes...
My lady is not diabetic.
...that anyone with so much to gain...
You do have one thing in your favor. Everybody hates you.
Well, that's a start.
Yeah, so, I mean...
As Ron Silver as Alan Dershowitz.
Wow.
I think a lot of people believe that he did it, and some people think he didn't do it, mm-hmm. and it's just so complicated.
Well, and it's like two rich families battling because his wife was from a separate rich family. Like, Klaus von Bulow, guess what? He's a very rich man as well, so they're both... It seems like a very weird tangle, which of course is what tabloids are going to love, that kind of fight.
And I think ultimately the joke is he bought justice, but only the rich can, you know, buy the justice they need. Mm-hmm. Because a poor person would not be able to assemble that defense team, like fucking Alan Dershowitz, to save his ass from prison.
I'd heard that argument about the OJ case. Most court cases could be torn apart in that same level if you had millions and millions of dollars to spend on lawyers that could do that, but you probably don't. So, speaking of smart moves by lawyers, Idle Hutz honestly makes a very good move of hiring Hibbert as a expert witness.
God.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to prove to you not only that Freddie Quimby is guilty, but that he is also innocent of not being guilty. I refer you to my expert witness, Dr. Hibbert.
Well, only 1 in 2 million people has what we call the evil gene. Hitler had it. Walt Disney had it. And Freddie Quimby has it.
Thank you, Dr. Hibbert. I rest my case.
You rest your case?
What? Oh, no, I thought that was just a figure of speech. K
Case closed.
And one of many Simpsons jokes associating Hitler with Walt Disney.
Yeah. Yes, yeah.
Merkin, I think it's Merkin.
That evil gene joke, that makes me think of, in the early 90s, a big thing was like finding the gay gene. Like, can we find the gene makes people gay? Well, so
I couldn't wrap my head around the Claus Van Bulow case. Mm. Other than Bart needed to say that so you'd understand why there was a doctor on the stand, because that's essentially who got him exonerated.
That might have made expert doctors famous.
Yeah, doctor testimonies.
Which, as in a few months, from this episode airing, O.J. Simpson will make DNA the most important thing.
Because it was not, especially in the late 70s.
Yeah. Apu is very conscious, is on the jury, of revealing that Homer has just been asleep. And
wait, who's minding the Quickie Mart?
Well, so how is Apu is on the jury, which, another continuity error, is that Apu is not a legal citizen. And in fact, when he becomes a legal citizen in the Proposition 24 episode, he is given jury duty notice and throws it away.
That's true. Oh, wow, so, Henry. So, good pull. Good pull.
All right. So see, another fireable blunder on the show. But the Homer's glasses are just such a great, it's such a great joke. Here's multiple things in this episode remind me of how many hours and hours of Law and Order I've watched that I'm just like, oh, a lawyer shouldn't do that in a big trial like this. And one thing is, you don't put your client on the stand unless you are totally sure of them.
That's for sure.
And I guess that is the hubris of not blue-haired lawyer, because he thinks that Freddie will definitely win them the case by going on the stand. But
well, therefore, you certainly would never lose your temper over something as trivial as the pronunciation of chowder. That's chowder! Chowder! I'll kill you! I'll kill all of you! Especially those of you in the jury!
You're really guilty.
Wow, that didn't go well.
He's sounding a bit like Krusty in the screaming, but it's like, let's all bask in his gentle decency.
Yes, he's so ready, and then he specifically says the people in the jury, that he'll kill the jury.
Especially those of you.
And that they're all ready to call it the end of the day, and that Jasper just wants to get home to watch the dolphins and Sequest meet the dog from Frasier. Everybody knows the dog.
Eddie's
going to
ride Darwin.
Yeah, so Sequest was a total fiasco of a show. It was Steven Spielberg makes a sci-fi TV series, a Star Trek for the 90s, and that... Unfortunately, though, that Star Trek for the 90s was very expensive and constantly interfered with by NBC. It started off as a big hit, and then it got shifted around on time slots and did so terribly that...
Yeah, I watched it.
And budget slashed, I believe.
And budget hugely slashed, and, well, because it was the crazy price of $1.5 million an episode, which in the early 90s was a lot for a TV show. And that Roy Scheider from Jaws was the captain of the ship. And halfway through the second season, he's like, just kill me. I'm out of here. And they kill him off and he leaves.
Darwin ate him.
And so, yes, Darwin was the talking smart dolphin, which sounded like this.
Swim!
Anything yet?
He wants to swim, I guess.
Swim, Lucas. Swim, Bridger.
Bart imagines himself as a lunch lady. I also like that thing.
That's the one dark future of Bart's he doesn't think is cool.
Yes, finally. finally.
Go, cool.
And then the woman being the judge finally pays off in Chicks on the Bench, where Bart still isn't ready to confess to what he knows. Then we get to the third section, which Homer is the absolute star of the third act.
He's got my favorite lines.
It's all about Homer and Skinner. Like, Skinner is all over the place in this episode. He's like in every part of it.
Homer and Skinner are a very underrated duo, as this scene will show, which I think this... Can we call this the line of the show? I think... No.
Let's hold our tongues here.
Okay, fine.
What does sequestered mean?
If the jury is deadlocked, they're put up in a hotel together so they can't communicate with the outside world.
What does deadlocked mean?
It's when the jury can't agree on a verdict.
Uh-huh. And if?
A conjunction meaning in the event that or on condition that.
So if we don't all vote the same way, we'll be deadlocked and have to be sequestered in the Springfield Palace Hotel.
That's not going to happen, Homer.
Let's vote. My liver is failing.
Where we'll get a free room, free food, free swimming pool, free HBO, ooh, free Willy!
Justice is not a frivolous thing, Simpson. It has little, if anything, to do with a disobedient whale. Now let's vote.
Are the rest of you voting?
Guilty.
Okay, fine. How many S's in innocent?
Oh.
I'm only doing what I think is right. I believe Freddie Quimby should walk out of here a free hotel.
So many, like, that those whole last, scene.
Yeah.
If.
Yeah, I just also just like, and if. And he explains the conjunction of and if. But yeah, deadlocked. I know I've done that a million times of like talking people through things of like, okay, so this word means this. And just like the way Homer theatrically presents those words, like, if.
And another great Skinner character moment. He views Free Willy as being about a disobedient whale.
Yes, that's
true. That whale should be back in its cage.
So. Well, yeah, Free Willy, you want to talk about that?
Sure. I mean, I guess, should we wait until we get the parody of
Free
Willy?
Oh, okay,
Willy?
Yes,
that we don't really see the, mm-hmm. the grisly parts.
Well, so then there would be, speaking of parodies, there was almost a parody, and Homer straight up denies the parody being allowed to happen.
You know, we're kind of like the original Odd Couple. You're the messy one, and I'm...
Shut up!
Yes, very well. Well, okay, this is part of a brief season 5 running series of jokes where Homer ends a scene with him yelling, shut up.
Yeah. Yes.
He's on the phone with NASA, and then they ask him a question. He says, shut up!
They ask him how he got that number. Yes. Shut up, as in denying an explanation to an obvious question.
Yeah, and then he's in Moe's bar with Stampy. Mm-hmm. And Moe's like, you're taking advantage of my peanut offer. Shut up! And there's the third shut up. So it's like a running joke throughout the season.
It is a beautiful joke, I guess you could only do in cartoons, that Skinner is dressed like Oscar from The Odd Couple.
Yeah, he's picking up the cigar with the umbrella.
Yeah, like, Felix's cigar. It's like you're bracing yourself for it, and to say shut up and just shit all over the joke.
You're just
is
ready
really
for the music to start up and there to be a full on parody of the opening, and then Homer's just like, shut up!
And I'm saying that obviously because I hadn't seen the fucking Odd Couple. I don't even know how I know what the intro looks like now. But yeah, what a great fucking gag.
But then they do see the Free Willy director's cut, and I do like the brief appearance of Nancy Cartwright as a non Bart character.
Yeah,
he crushed
true.
Our boy.
Yeah, that Free Willy parody is weird. It feels
like a critic.
I thought it was a critic joke, and I triple checked. I was like, was that joke also in the critic? And no, I just put it in there in my brain as a critic joke.
And I think the Mad or Cracked magazine parody that had a cover, it was Feed Willy, and it was Willy jumping over the rock and biting the boy.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. That's good. But Free Willy was a real flash in the pan, but it was big when we were kids.
It's got three sequels. It had an exclusive Michael Jackson song.
Yeah,
a soundtrack.
Yeah. Big Michael Jackson song.
Big soundtrack.
If you ask Michael Jackson to write a song for a boy, he will do it.
I would posit it's the most money Michael Madsen has ever made, as he's been in more than one of these.
I thought Elijah Wood was in this, but Flipper, right?
Yeah.
That's the Flipper movie.
Multiple films, including Flipper. I remember when they made that Flipper film, it felt like they thought, Free Willy's eating our lunch. We invented the sea mammal helping a kid thing. Theirs is just bigger.
I spent a lot of dark afternoons watching Flipper on Nickelodeon in that time when they had no original programming.
Yeah, but you're just like, well, this is still for kids, unlike everything else on TV right now. Yeah, it was, and I prefer Flipper to Lassie. I'd watch a Flipper. At least it was in color.
It would be in color, yeah. I mean, we can play a bit of the trailer. Okay. It's about a whale that doesn't want to be in a zoo anymore, I guess, or a holding pen. I don't know.
Imagine if the world you lived in, the space you breathed in, and the freedom you played in was suddenly taken away. Imagine if the only person who knew how you felt was a boy who felt it too.
Really like him, huh?
I don't want to imagine that. But this is so funny. This is 1993. You can still have a guy saying, in a world imagine.
And this was, it kind of capitalized off the anti-whaling boom of the 80s and 50s, 90s as well, which
it's important
now
to mention.
Who cares? Like,
it's
nah,
not,
I kid.
It's
no,
not
I
who
cares.
Like, they're about,
no,
like, isn't SeaWorld kicking out? It's orcas as we speak.
SeaWorld's in big trouble.
SeaWorld's swirling the drain.
Yeah.
Well,
but they're getting rid of their orcas.
Yeah. Well, and South Park had that perfect episode about it. Which most people remember for the poker face cover, but the one about stopping the Japanese from fishing whales, and that it ends with the Japanese only killing cows and chickens in the same way, and then they're just like, okay, see, it's fine now. It's normal.
I just, as a little kid, this and Star Trek Voyage Home led me to believe that whales were the biggest problem we had as a species.
Yep, we gotta unite for that.
Gotta save those whales.
So I want to spotlight, this is a season 5 superstar, that he went from being in the Brad Goodman episode it is really just a stitched together ADR line about a character on a cop TV show that now gets fully animated for one of like the most like hyper dense jokes they've ever done.
It's great, and yeah, Henry and Bart's Inner Child. The show ends with Homer yelling about McGarnacle.
Yes,
but we never see McGarnacle. That ending was all created in editing,
yes.
Not with any animation. It was all like stitched together stuff. But we actually see McGarnacle now, and I think they're using him because they can't use McBain. They can't do McBain parodies. So this is more of a Dirty Harry guy.
But a TV show Dirty Harry, too. So, but I love McGarnacle.
His chief is McBain's chief.
It's the same, which I guess they hired the same actor. In world, I mean.
Next on McGarnacle. McGarnacle is framed for a crime he didn't commit. And only one witness can clear his name. A little sissy boy who's too scared to come forward.
You gotta tell him what you saw, Billy.
But I'm so scared, McGarnacle.
You gotta do this one for me, Billy. McGarnacle.
Okay. For you, McGarnacle.
Well, McGarnacle, Billy is dead. He slit his throat midway.
Hey, I'm trying to eat lunch here.
Billy is dead.
So in 30 seconds, they say McGarnacle six times there.
McGarnacle was invented by George Meyer as a funny name. Yes.
McGarnacle.
Well, you know, maybe it's just because I watched Look Well recently, but it reminds me of the naming convention running gag they had in the Look Well pilot of, you were Bannigan. No, that was George Kennedy.
Yeah.
you were Mannix. No, like this, the McGarnacle sounds like a 70s cop show name.
It really does.
Like the overly complicated name. And that they just drop it in the episode like, a child is murdered on the show. Nobody really
McGarnacle
cares.
Doesn't care. He gave a child bad advice, and it was inconveniencing his lunch hour.
And it worked like an itchy and scratchy cartoon that could have scared Bart, but instead, it's a McGarnacle episode that does it. And then, speaking of dark things, this story Marge tells, it means a lot to her character background.
This is like the Charles Starkweather case we talked about in Homer Loves Flanders, where except it's a member of their family who went on a spree killing.
Seemingly Marge's brother, yes.
Mom. What if there's a really bad, crummy guy who's going to jail, but I know he's innocent?
Well, Bart, your Uncle Arthur used to have a saying. Shoot them all and let God sort them out. Unfortunately, one day he put his theory into practice. It took 75 federal marshals to bring him down. Now let's never speak of him again.
Mom. Mom. Mom.
Hmm?
What if I can get this guy off the hook? Should I do it?
Honey, you should listen to your heart and not the voices in your head, like a certain uncle did one gray December morn.
Oh, so dark.
Yeah, Marge really paints a picture, gray December morn.
So,
and I guess we never hear about Uncle Arthur after this.
As she said, never speak of him again.
Was he on Bewitched or something?
Yeah, that isn't Uncle Arthur, but that he is buried. She has buried it that deep, and it makes you wonder, is the Uncle Arthur, is she calling him Uncle Arthur because that was her uncle and would actually be Bart's great Uncle Arthur, or is that her brother? Is there an unspoken of brother of Marge's who did those things?
The lost Bouvier, I don't know.
It is a horrifying joke, but that they give it to Marge. I like when they find new things to do with Marge that isn't just, what are you guys doing in there? What are you doing?
She's good at repressing her emotions. Also, I feel like she actually fears that Bart will inherit this madness.
Oh.
And that's why she's like, don't listen to the voices in your head, Bart.
Oh my God, that's right. She's worried that this question from Bart is just like, well, wait, you're not developing this psychological issue too, are you? Bart makes his decision. It's a very flimsy but funny excuse that the judge gives of like why this unconstitutional thing is happening. But at least from what I've learned on Law and Order, having a member of the jury's son be the major witness in a case would be a mistrial immediately.
Oh, yeah.
They'd be like, well, this surprise witness is related to a jury member.
I think you mean a bad court thingy.
A bad court thingy. But Bart finally reveals that it was actually the waiter falling down. Lacoste fell down in a Clouseau-esque fashion. The animation, I didn't get the clip for it, but the animation of him tripping on the chair is so great. The way you feel the physicalness of the chair rolling around in his feet.
I love when he falls into the oven. It's really great animation. And the boiling water pouring on him. He should be disfigured.
I know. And then the tower of glasses, wine glasses falling on him. It's all perfect. And that he refuses that ugly stereotype, but he is the ugly stereotype.
He was so embarrassed by his own clumsiness, he sued another man to cover it up.
He wouldn't admit it, yes. That confession comes at a cost.
How could you have seen all this, Bart? Weren't you supposed to be in school?
I sort of skipped school.
I knew it! I knew you'd slip up sooner or later, Simpson.
What slip up? What are you talking about? He confessed it.
Quiet, I need this.
it's so sad. Like, quiet, I need this. Like,
and, I mean, the ending really underlines how just what a tiny man Skinner is, yes. And just how he does need this.
Well, yes.
The tiny victory in his pathetic life.
You testified for the Quimby boy, even though it was putting your own head in a noose. On the other hand, you skipped school.
I guess the two things cancel each other out, huh?
I'm a small man in some ways, Bart. A small, petty man. 3 months detention. Wait a minute, Bart. Make that 4 months detention.
What an asshole.
Another great, like, murkiny F.U. To the script as well. Just like, you thought this was going to be him softening. It's him It's him hardening.
There's no change of heart.
Yeah, and again, a small, petty man. Like, you can admit it. And then they didn't do a ton with it, but Homer stealing the stuff from the hotel was pretty funny. And especially that off-screen Barney thing of him just getting smashed with a table.
Yeah. Lowering furniture out of the window. Yeah. It's like, oh, these are souvenirs. We're supposed to take them.
Lowering him out of a window from, like, they are on, like, the 20th floor or something, too. But you figure they'd stop that the first one they make. No, you're lowering stuff out of the window. But
yeah, we cut to the Simpsons' bedroom, and they're just surrounded by hotel property.
You know, a lot of things happened around here while you were gone.
Great, Marge. I want to hear all about it.
Give me those.
Oh.
And those.
Oh.
And those.
Oh.
So, yeah, Homer has the last, we think, of his awake glasses stolen and broken.
I love those awake glasses. They're great. Well, all right. We didn't name a best line of the episode then. What is the line of the episode?
I think it's
the
children who are wrong. It has to be, right?
You're right. Well, then let's see that one more time.
That or innocence.
Why, there are no children here at the 4-H Club either. Am I so out of touch? No. It's the children who are wrong.
That is...
That's the joke.
It's the most enduring line. I just love
it. It will live on
forever.
It should
be a free hotel. Like, that's that's beautiful writing.
Yeah, I love them. They're both great. Yeah, but the children who are wrong is the most timeless one. I just didn't want to have our Wikipedia page say we didn't pick a line of the episode for this show, so we have to do it.
We can't let them down. We got No Boy Bobby too. So yeah, that was A Boy Who Knew Too Much. A really super densely joke-packed episode after a great but also very grounded episode that came before it. I think it's Skinner didn't learn a damn thing from that last episode, but he's still, like, at the top of his game, like, one of the best Skinner episodes. Homer gets a lot to do. Yeah. Marge gets a lot to do. Bart gets a lot to do. Just a great season 5 episode altogether.
Yep. This is there are two sides of the same coin, this episode. Like, this is the dark brother of the much more touchy-feely episode before it. And it is just a great, super jokey episode, and that can start with a story of kid playing hooky to then be a celebrity courtroom drama. And it all works.
Phil Hartman comes back too. Just everybody's here.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. It's an all-star episode, a really great one. And it's showing too that season 5, even as it's getting towards the end, it is not running on fumes. They are still going strong.
If you remember to our season 4 episodes, towards the end of that, I mean, we saw what was happening. We saw the fatigue in people. We saw what happens when you're starting a new show while finishing the old one. A lot of distractions. So yeah, I'm glad season 5 is remaining stable and funny and good, and I think it will until the end. So
I know the next two episodes, so I feel pretty
The last one, the last episode of season 5 is very, very low key, but it's still funny.
I freaking love that
one. It is a Greg Daniels episode. So yeah, that was Talking Simpsons.
Yeah, baby.
I have been your host, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. My other podcast is Retronauts, a classic gaming podcast every Monday and occasionally extra episodes on Friday at retronauts.com. Find it there or search for Retronauts in your podcast device. Anything you listen to podcasts with will find it. You can download episodes you want to listen to. I recommend the ones that we did. We did episodes about Bart versus the Space Mutants, Bart's Nightmare, and the Simpsons arcade game. Start with those and branch out. I think you'll like it. And I'll let Henry talk to you about the Talking Simpsons Patreon, which is exploding. My purse exploded.
Yes, hey, thanks again to everybody who has been giving to the Patreon and supporting us. You are making the show happen. Bob and I didn't have to keep doing a soul-crushing job for that. And whenever new episodes go live, you can follow me on Twitter to find out about that too, H-E-N-E-R-E-Y-G. But, of course, if you have the Patreon app on your phone, you'll get updated every time a new post goes live. And in case you don't know, every episode now goes up a week early on Patreon while going up on the classic feed. And there's a ton of other exclusives on there, too. My favorite that I keep wanting to push people to, I mean, obviously, the second episode of Talking Critic is really great, but there's also our interview with Paul Provenzano, who tells us so many very interesting things about working on the early Simpsons games, including Bart's Nightmare and Virtual Springfield. That's really, really cool. So patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
I also wanted to point out that all of our bonus content, you don't have to listen to it through Patreon, the website, or the app. Anything you use to listen to MP3s or podcasts, you can plug in the code you'll get when you sign up, and you can listen to all the bonus content through that. I use Downcast. You can also use iTunes, any podcast device, Overcast. Any program.
Yeah, I have switched from the iTunes thing to Overcast. I really like it quite a lot.
Yeah,
so
third-party ones are the way to go, I think.
Speaking of podcasts, Laser Time, you guys just came on and we talked about not a specific episode of The Simpsons, but its fucking impact and longevity. It was a lot of fucking fun. Why am I cursing so much? Without plugging the fart episode, which I might as well, like, somebody kill me. I don't think I'll ever do better than that.
You've topped out. It really was.
Should have been the last episode
finale.
Of Laser Time.
Should have been, but it isn't. And there's a follow-up video game video on youtube.com/lasertime. Let's call it Gaming's Greatest Farty Butts Remastered. Wow. No Simpsons in there, but a lot of other 90 cartoons you might recognize. A wall-to-wall characters farting set to classical music.
It better be in 4K, Chris, or
I'm going to try.
Taking my money away. So thank you so much for listening. This has been Talking Simpsons. Next week, we're going to dig into Lady Bouvier's lover. See you then.
Infotainment.